Have Professor Tamar Gendler with us. Professor Gendler is an American philosopher. She's the Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences at Yale University. She's also a professor of philosophy, psychology, and cognitive sciences at Yale. Professor Gendler, welcome to New Books Network.
Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here.
Let's talk about your contribution to this book. You have written this thought experiment, which is called Skywalk, and it's an experiment in the philosophy of mind. So can you describe the experiment to us, please?
Sure. So I want to ask you, as one does with thought experiments, to engage in an act of imagination. And I want you to imagine that you go to visit the Grand Canyon in America, which is a canyon that's more than 3,000 feet deep, thousands of meters deep. And you go to visit, there's a tourist exhibition there, which is a glass balcony that you can go and step on. And so you step out on this glass balcony, which is above the canyon, and you look down, and beneath your feet, you see nothing. The glass is perfectly transparent, and you see thousands and thousands and thousands of feet of empty space, and then far, far, far below your feet, the rushing of the Colorado River. I want you to imagine you're standing on this glass balcony, thousands of feet in the air. I want you to imagine the range of feelings that you have. So one of them, presumably, is that you feel anxious. You're going to feel a sense of vertigo while you're there. You're going to feel like you're shaking and uncomfortable and worried. But that isn't something that you believe. And I can prove that, because if you believed that you were in danger, if you thought there was any real risk, you wouldn't voluntarily pay money to go out on this glass extension. And most particularly, imagine that you brought your children or your partner or someone you love tremendously with you out onto that platform. You wouldn't do something that put them explicitly in danger. So the thought experiment asks you to consider what could possibly be going on in your head, since without question, you believe that you're safe. How should we describe the fact that even though you believe you're safe, you brought your child, you paid your money, you're standing there without any genuine worry that you're going to fall? How do we explain the anxiety? And I have coined a term, which I call Alief, and I'm happy to talk more about that in a few minutes, to describe that automatic response that you have of fear. So when you're standing out on a glass balcony, you believe that you're safe, you Alief that you're in danger, and the thought experiment of the glass skywalk is meant to give you a concrete example where you notice about yourself that your head is full of A-leafy and B-leafy things at the same time.
And that's where you coined the term you just mentioned, Alief, to describe this automatic bodily reaction or experience, let's say. Can you kind of elaborate on that, Alief, and give us another example? Because in the book, you give us some other examples that show how actually Alief is in play in our everyday lives without us even noticing how it's impacting on our judgment, maybe.
Good, thank you so much. So I want to talk about Alief in two ways. The first is I want to explain, just using some language, why it's called Alief. And secondly, I'll give some additional examples. But while I describe the etymology of the term, that is why I chose A as the prefix, I want you to remember, we're thinking about how do we describe the sensation you have of fear and anxiety, though you truly believe and know that you're safe? And the answer is that Alief is automatic. It is something that is affective, that is, it tends to involve emotional responses. It's associative, that is, it is connected with the associative set of links with. it's something that we share with non-human animals in the sense that it tends to be responsive to aspects of our evolutionary structure that aren't necessarily prefrontal cortex, that is, that are in the parts of our brain that are automatic, associative, and evolutionary instilled as the result of our animal. And there are other things that you could use to remind yourself mnemonically, it is irrational. That is, it's not rational, it's not irrational, it's irrational. So that's why it's called Alief. It also comes before belief. So those are some ways of remembering that for the contingencies of language, it starts with an A. Now, let me give you some more examples of Alief. We have them all the time. So let me give you one piece of beautiful, delicious, spectacularly yummy chocolate fudge. And while you're sitting there, I roll it up so that it comes to take the familiar form of something that comes out of the back of non-human animals. You will, even if you believe that it is fudge, feel a certain amount of disgust and repulsion because your Alief will tell you that what you are looking at is not something that is fit for human consumption. Anytime you have something that is a surrogate object that you recognize to be artificial, when you walk around at Halloween or Carnival or whatever the festival holiday that you have in your culture, you will believe that everybody's dressed up in costumes, but you will nonetheless have instantaneous Aliefs as of encountering dragons or whatever else you see. And in fact, you might think of all of visual and auditory fictional representation through the lens of Alief. Suppose you're watching a movie and something sad happens in the film, or you're watching a movie and there's a sound that makes you jump. I want you to think through, let's take the jump case, right? Somebody does, there's a threatening figure on a film screen looming and coming towards you. Do you believe that you're in danger? No, here's evidence. It looks exactly like it did in the Skywalk case. You don't believe you're in danger. And here's what I can tell you. You haven't moved. You're staying in the theater. You didn't take and protect your children or your loved one. You believe that you're safe. Nonetheless, you had an emotional response. You ducked or you cried. You could have this happen even with a movie where you know exactly what's going to happen next. So those are some other examples of Alief. That is, cases where you interpret an object on the basis of its surface features, even though that you know that its deep features differ from that. And that is what almost all aesthetic representation plays off of. So that's another domain in which we find Alief at play.
I really enjoyed the way you described it in terms of bodily emotions and affect. I remember reading something from Brian Masumi who described affect as this automatic bodily reaction to external events. And you had some really great examples there. And when you were bringing up those examples, I was reminded of how, for example, in our everyday life, we might judge a person based on their looks, because that's even against our will to do that, we might, you know, involuntarily be a little bit predisposed to make a judgment or to form a judgment in our mind, and then maybe we quickly get over it. But I guess the concept of Alief that you brought up is a good example to describe that. Am I right to assume that sometimes it reinforces the stereotypes, or it kind of reinforces the inbuilt biases that we humans have?
So it's interesting that we classify some overlearned associations as biases and some overlearned associations as knowledge. Because in fact, what the things that we call biases encode are patterns that we've encountered in the world. Human beings ultimately are pattern encoders, and we tend to see something and then we see something adjacent to it and we come to have a certain association. Some of those associations are enormously helpful. In fact, most of those associations are enormously helpful. We come to associate things that cause pain in the body with danger. It's a really good thing that you associate not having anything under your feet with a situation that you don't want to place yourself in. It's a really good thing that you have an overlearned association of a looming object and the need to pull back. The problem is that we live in a world of injustices. And so what we encode automatically are the facts and patterns that we see. And to the extent that certain forms of embodiment are associated with certain forms of social location in a hierarchical system, we learn that the world is the way it is. And here's a funny thing about Aliefs. You don't get to choose which ones you have. So if you live in a society that is hierarchically structured by race or hierarchically structured along certain kinds of gender expression or hierarchically organized along certain modes of religious self-presentation, you will, with exactly the same system that teaches you, keep my hand away from fire, it is hot, and exactly the same system that teaches you automatically to type on a keyboard or to drive on the side of the road that it's customary to drive in your country, your learning mechanism encodes the patterns that you encounter. And so if you live in a society that is structured around racial or gender or other sorts of hierarchical classifications, you will come to have a set of implicit associations of power and prominence with the dominant visual representation and of subjugation with those who don't fall in that category. I've just described to you what people call implicit bias. Implicit bias, which is an area of study in a lot of psychological literature, is the recognition that even if you affirmatively are trying to be egalitarian, if you have been raised in a society or a planet where most of us live, where racial categories make a difference in terms of what you have encountered, your associations will reflect that. Implicit bias is no different from pulling your hand away when something looks like a fire or reaching towards something that you've come to associate with having it be appealing. It's how brains make sense of the world. But it brings out something really interesting about our beliefs. Sometimes we like to have them out of line with our beliefs. It wouldn't be fun to go to an amusement park if you really were scared when you're on a roller coaster. What you want is the interplay between your belief that everything's fine and your Alief that everything's risky. Or think about the joy of watching a sad film or of putting yourself into a situation of fear when you read a horror novel. The juxtaposition, my belief is like this, my Alief is like this, is the joy of it. That's why people pay to go out on the glass skywalk at the Chicago Tower, at the Grand Canyon. They have these all over. But sometimes we want our beliefs and our Aliefs to be in alignment with one another. And I'll give you two examples. One is the very serious one, which is if you hold a set of implicit biases because you live in an unjust society, you will find yourself just like a machine that engaged in machine learning. Everything that we call algorithmic bias is just because the only thing, in some sense, that computers have is Aliefs. They just have these sorts of associative patterns. So just like a computer encoding information that picks up correlations in the world, your brain encoded information that picked up correlations in the world. But if you have an avowed desire to be anti-racist, or you have an avowed desire to be egalitarian, or you have an avowed desire to treat things in the world differently than they happen to be patterned in the world for whatever reason, it's going to take you extra effort at that moment to bring your Aliefs in line with your beliefs. So a lot of the anti-biasing literature involves providing you with fundamental prototypes of a kind that allow you to bring those associations to the fore. So you're never going to lose the set of associations that you picked up as a result of navigating the world. You've lived in a society that's structured in a particular way. But if you provide yourself with images, for example, if you're interested in racial bias, and you provide yourself with images that come to your mind in a way that Alief's do, that allow you to see parity across embodiment, you will have less tension between your beliefs and your Alief's. Okay, so I said that was the serious example. Here's a fun example. This is an audience of listeners, some of whom are in countries that were in the British Empire and some of whom are in countries that weren't. That is to say, some of whom drive on the left and some of whom drive on the right. Driving is another case where you want your beliefs and Alief's to align. In fact, one of the ways in which you can see that you cross the street on the basis of Alief is to go from a Commonwealth country to a non-Commonwealth country or vice versa, and to discover that you don't know which way to look when you're crossing the street. The cars are coming from the wrong direction. It's not like you don't believe you're in London or New York, but your Alief's are causing you to look the other direction. Now, that's a playful case. That is a case where your Alief's and beliefs are out of line, and it's a problem because it's just a lagging habit. We have this all the time, right? You rearrange your kitchen. Your Alief's have the entire kitchen mapped out where things used to be. So even if you believe that you've moved the forks from the left side to the right side, you're going to have trouble finding them. But what these bring out, and I think it's really important as you think about implicit bias, which I think is often treated as grounds for moral condemnation, is that in the end, we're pattern picker uppers. If we live in an unjust society, we're going to pick up unjust patterns. Those are going to be what we see automatically. We have a moral obligation to try not to have those govern our behavior. But in the end, actually, a cost of living in an unjust society is that our instincts are going to pick up the patterns in the world around us.
There were wonderful examples describing Alief and belief, especially moving from a non-Commonwealth country to a Commonwealth country. That happened to me. I almost got killed twice, not knowing which direction to look. Thank you very much, Professor Gendler, for sharing your thoughts with us. It was amazing.
Thank you. It was great fun, and they were wonderful questions. You're a spectacular interviewer. Thank you.
Thank you very much.